the radiance of perfect love now shines for all to see. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. That held us now gives way to Him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive in me. And Your name. By Your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In Your name I come alive to declare Your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By Your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In Your name I come alive to declare Your victory. Come on. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By Your Spirit was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the Your name is victory.
Well, good morning and welcome to Now Then Alliance. I'm glad you could join us, whether you're joining in person or joining us digitally, and excited that we've got time to worship together this morning. Here at church, we do that each and every week, trying to honor who God is as our creator, as our savior, as king of the world, and we're excited to do that in a variety of different ways this morning. We're going to worship through song here in just a moment. We'll also spend some time studying God's word, as we usually do, continuing our series through the gospel of John, and then this morning particularly, we have the opportunity to celebrate communion together. And so if you're in the building, I hope you grabbed communion elements as you came in. Otherwise, there'll be time here still throughout the service that you'll be able to do that before we celebrate it. If you're home, you can feel free to grab some communion elements to be prepared for that as we get ready to worship in that way as well. I hope you've come with a heart ready to praise God, but also a heart ready to hear from him what he might be saying to you or to your family here this morning as well. In just a moment, Pastor Nathan's going to lead us in some musical worship. But before he does that, I just want to set our hearts in the right frame of reference through prayer together. And I'm hoping that you'll join me in that prayer. God, we recognize who you are, and we're here to celebrate that. To lift you up, to lift your name up, to put you in the right place on the throne of the universe, and then also to hear from you. And so we come with expectant hearts that you might speak words that are particular to us as individuals, as well as words that may shape us as a community. And pray that as we do that, as we listen, as we respond, as we worship you this morning, it would all be pleasing and acceptable to you as worship, and that it would be transformative in our own hearts to accomplish your will and your heaven here on earth this morning. Morning as well. We pray all of it, knowing it's reliant on you being at work, and so we ask it all in Jesus' name, amen. If you're here with me, would you stand with us as we worship this morning?
Let's lift your heart to Jesus today.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
Him.
the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Amen. You may be seated.
Well, if I haven't had the privilege of meeting you before, my name is Nate Kemper. I'm the lead pastor here at Now Then Alliance Church. Love that we get to gather together and worship each and every week. As a church, we exist to equip people to find life and faith in Christ, and we believe we do that best as we're connecting with each other, as we're growing in our own relationship with God and encouraging others to do the same, and as we participate in what God is doing in our life and in the world around us. And I want to just give you some of the opportunities that are coming up over the course of the next week or so where you can engage in those kinds of activities. One of those, if you've been around the last couple of weeks, we've been letting you know of our upcoming missions conference starting this Wednesday night through the weekend. Chris and Jamie Odell will be here. They're some of our ministry partners from Taiwan, and they're in town for a couple of months, actually, so we'll see them quite a bit. But this next week, they'll be leading our missions conference, and that'll kick off on Wednesday night with activities for our students and our youth, some of those in the building and some of those experiences that are off-site as well, but ways for them to engage and get to hear about what ministry and how God is active in Taiwan and what that looks like through the Aroma Coffee Shop. And then actually on Wednesday night, our kids will get to hear via the wonders of the internet from Rose Friedel, one of our other ministry partners, as she's in Taiwan still, but we'll communicate some on that Wednesday night with our kids as well. And so they'll get to see and experience how God is working all around the world. And then on Sunday next week, Chris and Jamie will be sharing the message with us that morning about how God has been active in and through their ministry and what it looks like to reach people for Christ in an environment and a culture where most people don't know Jesus and haven't heard the good news. And so they'll be here with us next Sunday. As a part of that, there'll be information that we'll hand out as well as a pledge card for you to start thinking and praying through what it looks like for you to maybe participate and join in God's work around the world and how God might be using your efforts or your finances to help send missionaries all around the world to the places that most need it. And so we're excited about that and anticipate great services with them here next Sunday morning as well. And then I want to let you know about an opportunity tonight for you to participate in more worship in a really comfortable, casual environment. We're having worship at the Barn. That's B-A-R-N, not bar, but barn. That'll take place tonight at 8752 Viking Boulevard. That's just a couple of blocks down Viking Boulevard. There'll be a driveway there. It's got a couple of stone pillars you can see when you're getting ready to turn into it. But if you're the kind of person who wants to plug it into a map, 8752, that's tonight at 6 o'clock. Great time. Pastor Nathan will lead in some authentic worship of who God is. And so come ready to praise him in a focused time of musical worship this evening. Well, many of us choose to give back to God by worshiping, by giving back to God some of what he's blessed us with. If you're new or visiting, please feel no pressure or obligation to give. But if you'd like to join us in giving, there's a couple of different ways you can do that. If people came prepared to give physically, there's a box in the back of the building you can give in as you leave. Otherwise, some prefer to give digitally. You can give through our website at nowthenalliance.org/give, or some people choose to give by text. You can text the number with give and then a dollar amount. The first time you do that, it'll walk you through a registration process of how you want to do that. Otherwise, you can give via text at any time after that as well. Regardless of if or how you may choose to give, we want to pray that we would receive these gifts well, that God would use them well for the advancement of his kingdom. And so I'd invite you to join me in that prayer. And God, we recognize all good things come from you and that you bless us in numerous ways. The most important way, through new life that you extend to us through Christ. And yet we recognize many other blessings in our lives. And so as we take time to give some of those back to you, we pray it would be pleasing and acceptable to you as an act of worship, that you would use these gifts to spread your love and to grow your kingdom in a world that could desperately use more of it. Pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's sing.
Who has the power to raise the dead? Who can save us from our sin? He is our hope, our righteousness. Jesus, only Jesus. Who can make the blind to see? Who holds the keys that set us free. He paid it all to bring us peace. Jesus, only Jesus.
Let's all stand together as we sing.
Holy King Almighty, Lord, saints and angels all adore. I join with them and bow before Jesus, only Jesus. Who can command the highest praise? Who has the name above all names? You stand alone, I stand amazed.
Darkness has to flee by the power of Jesus' name. Amen.
You will command the highest praise. Yours is the name above all names. You stand alone. I stand amazed. Jesus, only Jesus.
You will command.
You will command the highest praise. And all your people sing along.
in Him. Your grace is enough for us, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You may be seated.
It's always a joy to be able to worship God together. One of the things we'll see this morning when we begin in our message through the Gospel of John is that Jesus finds purity of worship to be important. And while that worship happens in a number of different ways, through singing, through giving, through studying, one of the things that's clear is there's a few things Jesus actually instituted as part of our worship. At His Last Supper, He instituted what we call communion, the elements of the bread and the cup that we utilize to remind ourselves and to reflect on Jesus' death and resurrection that was for us. When Paul was talking about it to the church in Corinth, he said that whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death till He comes. That we're participating in making Jesus known to the world around us, anticipating His return. That part of our worship would include communion. But as He institutes it, He gives some instructions on what it looks like to take communion well. This is what He writes to the church in Corinth. Whoever eats of the bread or drinks of the cup in an unworthy manner would be guilty of sinning. And what that means, as we interpret it, is that we're supposed to take communion in a worthy manner. We define that at this church by an understanding of faith. If you believe Jesus is your Savior, then we encourage you to take the elements of communion with us. If that's not a choice that you've made, if you haven't given your life over to Christ, we encourage you to reflect on His love represented through His death and resurrection, but maybe not take the elements with us. He goes on, Paul does, to say, everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. And we don't take this lightly. It's a holy and sacred celebration. So there's a couple of different ways that may look for you. You may choose as a part of that to sit reflectively or in prayer as we get ready to take the elements together and the band leads a song. Or others of you may choose to sing in worship along and to allow your worship to be part of your self-examining of your heart and who God is to you. Either of those are appropriate. To sit in silent reflection or to sing along is appropriate as we prepare for taking Jesus' elements of communion, the bread representing His body and the blood, or the cup representing His blood poured out for us. In just a few moments, we'll do that. And so if you haven't gathered elements during this song, would be a great time. If you're at home and need to get those round up, that would be a great time as we continue in examination and in worship, anticipating the celebration of communion in just a few moments.
In the darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill. that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death.
Amen.
And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. Praise forever to the King of Kings.
The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. When we had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." God, we're thankful for Jesus' willingness to have his body broken when it's ours that deserved it. Yet we recognize that his broken body wasn't the end. A beating and a punishment wasn't enough. It required the shedding of his blood. We pray that as we reflect on that, that you'd use these moments to transform us, to deepen our love for what Jesus has done for us. We pray it in Jesus' name. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." God, we don't deserve what Christ did for us, his life in exchange for our own, so that we could have, through the power expressed in his resurrection, the ability to have new life as well. We're thankful for that most clear act of love on our behalf, and pray that as we celebrate that, as we reflect that, as we proclaim his death in anticipation of his return, that it would orient us well to the kingdom of love that you've ushered in, and that our lives would then follow that, rooting everything we do in what you have said and revealed to us as best. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with me as we continue to sing in celebration of who God is?
Jesus Christ, crucified, bled and died to save our lives. Giver of boundless love, faithful one, to you we run. Every knee will bow, every tongue will shout, Jesus is the Lord, Jesus is the Lord. Jesus is the Lord, Jesus is the Lord. will shout, Jesus is the Lord. Jesus is the Lord. Every eye will see the coming of the King. Jesus is the Lord. Jesus is the Lord. You're worthy of worship. You're worthy of praise. You're worthy of honor. You're worthy of thanks. You're worthy of worship. You're worthy of praise.
Yes, you
you're
are.
Worthy of honor. You're worthy of thanks.
Put your hands together.
You're worthy of worship. You're worthy of praise. You're worthy of honor, you're worthy of thanks, you're worthy of worship, you're worthy of praise, you're worthy of honor, you're worthy of
you're worthy,
you're worthy of worship, you're worthy of praise, you're worthy of honor, you're worthy of thanks, you're worthy of worship, you're worthy.
The Lord. Come rule and reign today, Jesus. You may be seated.
Well, if you brought a Bible and are going to want to follow along, I'd encourage you to turn it to John chapter 2 as we continue in our series through the Gospel of John, a series that will last us a number of weeks, probably all the way up through Christmas, as we look at what the Gospel of John shows us about Jesus. Just by way of reminder, as the Gospel of John is structured, it begins with kind of an opening prologue talking to us about who Jesus is, particularly what it was like before he came to earth, that he was in face to face intimate relationship with God, that he was involved in creation, and that him coming to join us here on earth is the Creator God coming to live in the flesh with us. It moves from the prologue to what I'll title the Book of Signs, and from chapters 2 through about 11 or 12 or so, the author, John, is telling us a number of signs that Jesus performed or accomplished while he was here that reveal to us who he is as the Son of God. He writes these things in hopes that we would believe that Jesus is the Son of God. You may remember that. I've read these verses every week. They're near the end of the gospel, but in chapter 20, this is what John says about why he wrote this gospel. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written, the ones that John has recorded, these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. As John is writing this story of Christ's life for us, he writes it in hopes that we would see what Jesus has done, that we would believe that he's the Messiah. But not that it would end with just an understanding or a belief, but that we would proactively then put that into practice. We would have life in his name. John will record 7 of those signs. The first of them we looked at last week, where John is telling the story of Jesus at the wedding in Cana, where Jesus uses a miracle, the miracle of turning water into wine, to meet a genuine need. And we talked about how Jesus still wants to meet genuine needs in our own lives, that we can still involve Jesus in the things that are going on in our lives, that we can hope that he would come and meet the needs we have, whether they feel deeply significant or whether they feel like a party that's running out of wine. Times insignificant, that Jesus, when he's invited in and involved in our lives, wants to help meet the genuine needs of our life. And today we'll look at the second of those signs as John records it. It comes just a couple of days after that wedding in Cana when John writes these words in chapter 2, verse 13. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, the Jewish Passover, if you're unfamiliar with what that is, it was an annual celebration dating back to the days when Israel had been freed from slavery in Egypt. There had been a number of ways God had shown his power to Pharaoh and the Egyptians. The culminating act of that was what would end up being the slaying of all the firstborn kids of those families. And yet before he had done that, he warned his people, the Jews at that time, that if they wanted that to not happen, that they could put the blood of the lamb over their doorpost and the angel that was the angel of death, as he's called in Scripture, would pass over their houses. As the people of God in the Old Testament looked at God's actions, they thought that this Exodus story, and particularly this miracle that God was doing to open the eyes of Pharaoh to his power, was the most significant act. And so they had a holiday oriented around this Passover, this celebration that would happen every year. And as a part of that, it was integral in a number of areas of faith for the Jewish people. It was a time for many of them, the once a year that they came to the temple, where they believed God's presence dwelled, and they would offer the sacrifices of the blemish-free animals that they knew they needed to provide for themselves or for their family, for the different kinds of offerings they wanted to give God. It was also the time that everybody would come to give their annual offering to the temple. That was something that needed to happen for everybody that was 20 years or older in Israel. If you were over 20 years, there was a portion of your income you would give to the temple. And so they would come and give that offering, usually at the Passover celebration. And it says Jesus went up to Jerusalem at this time. In the Gospel of John, this is one of three, arguably four different Passovers that he covers, covering the whole gambit of Jesus' adult ministry. This is likely in Jesus' first year of ministry, right as he's beginning to minister, and he goes up to Jerusalem for the Passover celebration. And I want us, before we jump in the story, to spend a little bit of time thinking about what that would feel like. What kinds of sights and sounds would there be as you would walk towards the temple? At a time of year where people had gathered for the largest kind of gathering and festival and holiday that would take place. What would you hear? No doubt as people had gathered for worship, you may hear sounds of singing. No doubt as people had gathered to come to worship, if they had understanding of the Old Testament, they had likely memorized a number of the Psalms that are called the Psalms of Ascent, often recited when you would walk the temple steps up to the temple. And so maybe you would hear the reciting of Scripture that sounded the same as you had heard a number of times before. You'd no doubt probably hear people talking about their excitement about being at the temple, their awe of how it had been built and constructed, the joy they have of remembering Passovers past with their family and worshiping together. What kinds of things would you see or smell? Just what would the experience be like? More offerings and sacrifices were taking place at this time than any other time of year. And so the sound and smell of animals being burnt, being sacrificed, the aroma of meat being cooked for the priests and for the family to enjoy as part of the celebration they would make with their burnt offerings to God. You would see and you would hear these kind of holiday celebrations as people came together. And we get that. We have annual celebrations in our own lives that we recognize have certain sights or smells or sounds to them. We can think through them like the state fair that brings people from all around, and there's great people watching as you watch, and there's all sorts of unique smells, whether that's the wonderful deep-fried food or the August and September body odor of hundreds of thousands of people. There's smells that we associate with these annual celebrations. We can think through it like maybe of the times where we would have a home game of the Vikings hosting the Packers and what the tailgating would sound like and smell like as people from all around may come and gather together for an experience that they're looking forward to, a special set-apart time. Concerts, when your favorite band is in town and you show up and everybody knows the words to all of the songs and you feel like you're united in unison as you celebrate common ground together. We see it even at our churches. There are still religious holidays. And we recognize that at Easter and Christmas, we see people attend a church that might not attend regularly throughout the year. There were seasons of my life where that was my pattern. In some places we lived growing up, we went to church consistently. In other places after we'd move, we never found a church home. And so I was only in church on Christmas and Easter for large parts of my childhood. And we recognize that here at a church. Whether you know it or not, in order of attendance, Easter's generally the most attended Sunday of a year. Christmas Eve is always second. Mother's Day is third. That's the pattern of attendance as it's around holidays and celebrations. And as we recognize that, it means when Easter and Christmas come around, we often want to be prepared for our new guests. And so we try to create an experience that gets to the core of who God is and how we can explain Him most fully to people who don't engage with faith normally. We use those kinds of holidays, those unique celebrations where people who aren't normally around come to join us as a place to prioritize our guests and that clarity. But when Jesus goes to Jerusalem at this particular celebration, that's not what he finds. That's not what he sees and hears. That's not what he smells. It says this in verse 14. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. We'll see over the course of the next couple of verses that what Jesus sees is an inappropriate use of his temple, an inappropriate use by the people of God in the way that they're receiving the people that come around them. What we find is they're not prioritizing their guests, they're prioritizing profit. They recognize that this is a unique time, that they have ability to maybe make money in the midst of this experience of people coming from all over, traveling from far enough that they couldn't bring the blemish-free animals that they would need for sacrifice. And so when they would get there, the people at the temple courts would sell them those animals at a great upcharge. It says there's people exchanging money at the tables. This, again, was something where everybody over 20 was supposed to bring an offering to the temple, and yet the offering coins they likely brought wouldn't have been a pure enough silver for the temple offering. And so people would exchange in the courts the currency you had brought for temple currency that had a pure enough silver in what is best studied and understood as a 12.5% markup for a one-time exchange on money you're giving to God as an offering. You've come prepared to give of what God has blessed you with. And when you get there, the Jews who are running the temple at the time, they're sitting outside saying, that sounds great, but you need different money and we're going to charge you 12.5% interest to get that money in a one-time exchange so you can give your money away. They're not prioritizing their guests well. They're not prioritizing worship of God at all. They're prioritizing profit. We see that happen in our own worldly festivals. To this day, in America, the Super Bowl is the number one most resourced place for human trafficking. More human trafficking takes place at whatever city is hosting the Super Bowl than anywhere else in the country. Because as a large event happens where people are traveling out of town from, it is easy to not prioritize just the event itself that you're there for, but start to prioritizing profit in whatever ways it can be found. And this is what Jesus sees happening at the temple, in the courts there. And so he is mad. It says in verse 15, so he, Jesus, made a whip out of cords, and he drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers, and he overturned their tables. Instead of hearing the sounds of worship or the reciting of scripture of people walking up the steps, instead of smelling the offerings taking place at the temple, what you see and hear now is unmistakable. It is cattle scattering. It is owners no doubt trying to chase them and wonder what's going on. It's chaos as you hear the coins hitting the stone walkways and floors and the thumps of the tables as they bend, are flipped over. It's the wondering when people are looking around saying, who's going to come deal with this? There's a crazy person causing chaos in the midst of the courts. Where are the temple of guards? Where are the Roman soldiers? Who's going to come and put order and structure around what's going on as people react to what Jesus has done? But I always wonder what it felt like just the moments before that. When Jesus is mad, and it says he takes the time to make a whip out of cords. It's likely that he gathered some cords that had been used to tether some of the animals. And I wonder, was it silent at that point? Were the people near him as he started grabbing cords, and I don't know if he's braiding them or what he's doing, tying them together, but as he's fashioning a whip out of them, do they already know he's mad? Is he mumbling under his breath? Is he saying anything where they recognize he's agitated? Do they just think he's a random guy around about maybe to make a purchase? What did it feel like as he got ready? And then, how quickly did it flip? How quickly did they notice something wrong had taken place? How shocked were they when the animals started to flee, when they started to chase them, when the tables got turned over? How sudden did that feel? How much shock was there when it happened? I'd encourage you at some point to look through the different accounts of this story. Every gospel records something about Jesus cleansing the temple. And to start to ask questions like I ask, like the scholars ask, are these the same accounts? Or did Jesus do this multiple times? Now, I've said that throughout this series, the hope is that we would, as John says, that we would see these signs of Jesus and that we would believe, but then we would put them into practice. We would live life with Christ. And so my hope is that you'll find something, one thing that you can do throughout this week. And we may all find different things, but I've committed to giving you examples of different ways to connect or grow or participate. Those are our church's values that you may put into practice in regards to this message. And so I want to just pause for a moment and let you know one of the things you may choose to do to grow in your own faith. You may choose this week to study the different accounts of Jesus cleansing the temple from the Gospels. You can see them in Matthew 21, Mark 11, Luke 19, and here in John 2. If you don't write those down quick enough, we'll post it on our church Facebook page this week as well. You'll be able to find them there. And then begin to ask questions like, did this happen more than once? John records it here near the beginning of Jesus' ministries, but all of the other Gospels record it at the last Passover Jesus is at, right before the Last Supper, and assume that it was start of what instigated getting him arrested. What Old Testament scriptures are quoted or referenced by the disciples or by Jesus himself? The scholars debate if this happened more than once or not, and so I've got opinions. I'm not going to share them now because I'd love for you to do the research on your own and find what you think about how God has revealed himself and Jesus' understanding of the purity that the worship is supposed to be and not the prophet that had come alongside of it. So you may choose this week to grow by studying the cleansing stories in all of the Gospels. What we know is that Jesus continued. Not just did he scatter the people, but he started to make claims that are the reason John told the story. It says this in verse 16, "To those who sold doves, he said, 'Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market.'" It says he had to address those who sold doves because the whip wouldn't have scattered them. They were still in cages. But he didn't think they belonged either, and so he turned to their owners and said, get the doves out as well. They don't belong. This isn't a market. This is a place of worship. But he says something unique, and I think it's the reason John records the story for us. He says, "Stop turning my father's house into a market." And that's not language the first century Jews would have used. They wouldn't have called God the Father very often. If you're familiar with the Bible, the common phrase was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And they recognized they belonged to Abraham. They would have called themselves children of Abraham. They didn't yet often recognize themselves as children of God. And so Jesus saying, this is my Father's house, is a stake towards divinity. It's a claim that he belongs in a way nobody else belongs, that he is the child of God, that this is his Father's house, and that he expects it to function the way God intended, for it to be prioritizing worship of who God is. He's claiming divinity again. He is the loyal son returning his Father's house to true and proper, pure worship. And before we move on, a second thing you may apply in your own life as you want to participate in what God may be doing in you is to begin to evaluate, do you have pure worship as it relates to your faith, or have you prioritized profit? Evaluate how pure your worship is versus how profit-oriented it might be. And again, the hope isn't that we would just do a searching and get an answer, but that we would put into practice the right priority. So the hope is then you would align your focus with God and not simply the blessings that follow. Now let's be clear. God's word is clear. He has revealed to us there are many blessings for being in right relationship with God, and worshiping God well often ends up with him graciously blessing us with lots of things. But the priority has to be that those follow our relationship with God. They are not the goal of our relationship with God, and they never should supersede our relationship with God. And so evaluate your own faith. Is your own faith prioritizing who God is and worshiping him well? Or has it become about getting things to feel good for you? And the hope is as we evaluate it, we would then move from evaluation to aligning ourselves with a prioritizing of who God is, and not simply the blessings that follow. As Jesus has cleansed the temple, cleared the temple courts in that way, his disciples who have watched it have some responses. This is what they say in verse 17. His disciples remembered that it is written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." These are disciples who would have known the Old Testament scriptures well. And so as they watch Jesus get passionate, we might even argue righteously angry in the moment, what they see happen, they don't say, oh, look, Jesus is mad. Oh, look, Jesus is angry. Oh, look, Jesus is passionate. They say, he has such great zeal for the house of God. He is consumed by his zeal. The disciples watch Jesus in action, and what they remember is that it is helpful and healthy to have passionate zeal for the kingdom of God. It is not quoted by Jesus as what he was doing. It is what the disciples observed in Jesus. Zeal for the kingdom of God that has consumed them. And my hope is, because I believe this still happens, that as we interact with God, as he places his spirit inside of us, that we grow and try to have the heart of God inside of us, that we would have passionate zeal for the kingdom of God as well. And what I'm aware of is that for many of us, that may function out in very different areas. None of us have the full, complete heart of God. I think we're all aware of that. And so none of us have perfect zeal and passion for all the things God is zealous and passionate about. But my hope is we might identify some areas where our spirit or our heart has been stirred towards God. So I'll give some examples. In my life particularly, I have deep passion for helping end human trafficking. Right now, particularly in my life, that plays out in behaviors that help that on the border of Nepal and India. One of the worst places for human trafficking with least access to the gospel in the world. I am passionate about that. And so I have aligned behaviors in my life around that being an expression and a worship and a zeal and a passion for the kingdom of God. That doesn't have to be the issue that you're most zealous and passionate about. It can be all sorts of things. Some of you may be really passionate about justice in our own societies or about care for the unborn, about outreach to people in your community who don't have access to the gospel, or about apologetics as you defend your faith to others, about connecting with others and encouraging them in their faith, or prayer and its power in the world. My hope is that you have zeal and passion that consumes you for some part of the kingdom of God. That's an appropriate expression of our faith. And when Jesus' behaviors were in action, people looked around and said, oh, I see that not simply as someone who's frustrated, not simply as somebody who's mad. I see that as somebody who's passionate and has God's heart's zeal consuming him over it. May the same be said of us in actions in our own life. In fact, if this week, if you're a different thing you're looking to apply, just trying to figure out what that looks like, maybe you don't even know the steps towards what it looks like in your life. You just know that you have a heart for it. I'd encourage you, if you're looking for a way to connect this week, to have a conversation with someone about your passionate areas of faith, yours and theirs. Ask them, what is it about your heart that you reach out for in the brokenness of our world that you'd love to see the kingdom of God overtake and claim back to righteousness again? Talk with someone about the passionate areas of faith, both yours and theirs. That's what the disciples see in Jesus as he clears the temple. But it's not what the Jews around him see. They responded differently. Verse 18 says, the Jews then responded to him, what sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all of this? Hey, you've just created mass chaos in the temple courts. Who are you? And why do you think you can do that? Show us a sign to prove your authority. I think there's a couple of things that are going on here. First, the Jews particularly have recognized God has had to confront them about this a number of times. If you read the Old Testament prophets, prophets like Haggai or Amos, you'll see that God consistently is saying, hey, you're showing up and you're doing some religious things, but your heart's in the wrong place and you've prioritized it bad. And the prophets have shown up and corrected them enough times that when Jesus has this chaotic display in front of them, they might look at it and say, okay, we need to discern real quick, is this an angry guy? Or has God sent us a prophet again? Is this a message we're supposed to listen to? I wonder if he can show us a sign to show his authority. Is he speaking for God or is he just mad personally? And so they ask him, what sign do you have? Can you show us what authority you have? Prove who you are and why we should listen to you instead of arrest you. Jesus doesn't want to give them a sign. He's not interested in that. So he answers them, destroy this temple and I'll raise it again in 3 days. And as they're standing in the temple, probably still the chaotic sounds around them, animals fleeing, people scrounging to pick up the money off the floor, Jesus says, you could destroy this temple and I'll rebuild it in 3 days. And they probably looked around and said, how? You may remember this isn't the first temple that Solomon had built. That one was destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar. This is the second temple that Ezra and Zerubbabel, they had rebuilt it, a little bigger than the first. But then in the early BCs, Herod the Great decided he wanted to magnify it. And so for 46 years, they've been expanding the temple. It's roughly 3 or 4 times the size of the original temple at this point. And it's been ornated with gold and elaborately decorated. It's magnificent. And the people there know that. So they wonder how he could be built in 3 days when it's taken decades. They respond with that. They replied, it has taken 46 years to build this temple. You're going to raise it in 3 days? And John says, but the temple he had spoken of was his body. It wasn't about the physical building. It was about knowing that if he was destroyed, he would raise again. In fact, John, written as the last of the Gospels, assumes you've read the others. I said that last week. What verse 22 tells us, it gives us the whole end of the story already. Verse 22, after he was raised from the dead, like talking about Jesus, that's just a big spoiler. That's the climax of the story. And Matthew, Mark, and Luke don't let you know that in advance. But John just assumes like, hey, I'm writing last. I assume you know the story. He says, yeah, you know, after he was raised from the dead and his disciples recalled what Jesus had said. And then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. A couple of years later, after Jesus rises from the dead, when the disciples are thinking through their interactions with him, they remember this day. They remember it as a sign of who Jesus was, that his authority was as the Son of God, that that was a sign, he had spoken it, and yet didn't do it for another 3 years, not until after he was dead. And that the disciples' own response to that was to believe even more who Jesus was and what the scriptures say about him. That's John's hope for the entirety of the gospel. Every story he tells is supposed to end with us having deeper understanding of who Jesus is as the Son of God, a belief in him, and then walking that out in our life as well. It's a sign for our belief. I'm going to pause for a moment, and I'm going to go on an admitted pastoring tangent. Just as your pastor, I want to go on my own soapbox tangent. This is not authoritative from the Word of God. This is just Pastor Nate talking. I see this story and the ones like it in the other Gospels used in ways that bother me personally. And so I want to remind us of a couple of things. First, what I want to remind us of, more often than not in our life, we are like the people who have been selling the doves and sheep and cattle and exchanging money far more often than we're like Jesus with righteous anger. More often than not in life, we will tend towards the side of our worship having become imperfect and impure and maybe starting to reach after profit or blessing far more often than we stand with righteous anger for what other people are doing wrong. I want to be clear. Righteous anger is a thing, and Jesus has it here. And it results in the flipping over of tables and a strand of whip of cords to drive out cattle. And where I get sometimes personally frustrated is when people use that as a reason to just be a jerk with their faith. To say, I've got example to show that Jesus was frustrated with some things about people and faith particularly, and he used that in angry kinds of ways and aggressive kinds of ways, and so I'm not being a jerk, I'm being like Jesus. I want to remind us, righteous anger is a thing, but most of our anger is not righteous. And most of Scripture warns us about how we respond to our anger. And very rarely are we supposed to put it into behavioral practice. We're supposed to deal with our anger very differently than that. It is not a fruit of the Spirit. And so if you're angry about things of your life, about things of the people of God, about some expression of faith, make sure before your anger becomes a behavior, make sure it's 100% righteous and on board with what God would want. And I would just warn us and caution us, most of the time it won't be. Righteous anger was even rare for Jesus. He could do it perfectly. Please don't get into a place where you're excusing your anger or your poor behavior towards others because you saw Jesus be righteously angry once. Do the work of finding out if your anger is righteous before you put it into behavior. I'm going to get off my soapbox now. This story recorded by John is written not so we could have an example of Jesus' anger, and not even necessarily so that we would see the first century's poor use of the temple. It is written so that we would believe even more that Jesus is the Son of God. We would see his zeal for right and proper worship, and we would recognize that that should be true in our own lives. We would see the misuse of prioritizing blessing or profit over worship, and we would evaluate our own lives accordingly. And then, not just believing those things, John says the hope is that we would have life in his name. And I don't know what that'll look like for you. My prayer and hope is that the Spirit of God will reveal that to you individually. But what I know is that each of us can take some kind of step this week to get closer to living like Jesus. I've given some examples. I'll remind you of them now. My hope is that you'll think through this morning, throughout the week, you'll think through, what's one thing I can do? What's one thing I can do this week to be a better follower of Christ? Here's the examples as I gave them throughout the message so far. Maybe you'll choose to do it through connecting with someone, particularly by talking with them about passionate areas of faith, your passionate areas of faith and theirs. And those may be things like sex trafficking, justice, the unborn, outreach, apologetics, connections, prayers, or a number of other things. Maybe you'll choose instead to focus this week on growing your understanding of God and how he's revealed himself through Scripture by researching the different accounts of Jesus cleansing the temple and asking the question, did Jesus just do this once, or are there multiple accounts of this? What kinds of Old Testament verses was Jesus referencing or the disciples referencing as they saw this take place? And what do we learn about God from it? Or maybe you'll choose to take a step in participating in how God's at work in your life by asking and evaluating how pure your worship is versus how profit-oriented it might be. And then move from just an understanding of where you may currently be to a proper alignment of your focus on being God first and not the blessings that follow. My hope is that each of us would get closer to God, closer to each other through whatever steps we may take, and I want to pray to that end. Would you join me in that? God, we're thankful for John's clarity on who Jesus is. We're thankful for the scripture's clarity on your heart for our worship to be first and foremost about who you are and not about the functions or the mechanics or the blessings or the profit, but to be about honoring you and putting you in the right place over the universe, over our lives, over our world and the community that surrounds us. Help our hearts to reflect that. Help it to move from our hearts to our actions and for our actions to reflect that. Show us where our worship is pure so we can be affirmed that we're doing things well, and show us where maybe it needs to be corrected so we can align our focus more properly towards you. And continue to reveal Christ to us so we fall deeper in love with more clarity, like it says the disciples were as they've seen his behaviors, more clear on who he is and how the scriptures speak to us. Help us get to that place as well, we pray, knowing it's reliant on your work in our lives. And so we ask it all in Jesus' name, amen. A quick reminder before you go, we'd love to have you join us at the barn for worship tonight. That's at 6 o'clock, just down the road a couple of blocks, 8752 Viking. If you want to write that down or if you want to look it up, it'll be on our Facebook page as well. You can find it there. Come for a night of worshiping God well together. We hope it will be pure worship where we will prioritize all of us in the room focused on God and not simply on blessings that are there for us. As you go this afternoon, grace and peace to you. Go well, and thanks for joining us. Hope to see you again next week as we continue worshiping God together. You are dismissed.